Hi, this is Gio. I'm back with class number 7 of the course on Signals and Systems from Universitat Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona. Please see my webpage for more information about me and do get in touch by email if you have any doubts on the classes. In the last class, we started learning some of the basic properties of the Fourier transform. We'll continue today by exploring the relationship between convolution and multiplication in the time and frequency domains. Let's get started. Convolution is a very useful operation, as we have seen, that allows us to calculate the response of a linear time invariant system by knowing its input x of t and its impulse response h of t. We will now show that performing the convolution of two signals in the time domain corresponds to multiplying their respective Fourier transforms. So let's recall the definition of convolution. The convolution between two signals h of t and x of t is given by the integral of x of tau h t minus tau d tau. It has the property of being commutative, so the convolution between h and x is the same as the convolution between x and h. And in particular, we can see this as the convolution between the input of an LTI system and its impulse response, where x of t usually denotes the input and h of t usually denotes the impulse response. And the result of this operation, which we could denote by y of t, is the output of the LTI system. So the important property we see today is that in the Fourier transform domain, the Fourier transform y of j omega of the output is given by the product between the Fourier transform of the impulse response h of j omega and the Fourier transform of the input x of j omega. And in particular, h of j omega, Fourier transform of h of t, is denoted the frequency response. So the convolution property is of great importance in signals and systems analysis because the Fourier transform maps the convolution of two signals into the product of the Fourier transforms. And h of j omega, as we just said, the Fourier transform of the impulse response, is the frequency response. It captures the change in the complex amplitude of the Fourier transform of the input at each frequency omega. For example, in frequency selective filtering, we may want to have h of j omega equal to 1 over a certain range of frequencies, such that the frequency components in this band experience little or no attenuation or change due to the system, while over another range of frequencies, we may want to have h of j omega close to 0, so that components in that range are eliminated or significantly attenuated. We'll see this in more detail. It is actually possible to easily prove the relationship that we have just presented as follows. So if y of j omega is the Fourier transform of y of t, we can write it according to the definition as the integral of y of t, which is between square brackets the convolution between x and h, times e minus j omega t dt. Then we note that it's possible to invert, to interchange the order of integration, and x of tau does not depend on t, so we can take it out and obtain the second line, which is that the integral of x of tau times the quantity in square brackets, which is the integral of h of t minus tau e minus j omega t dt, in d tau. And we notice that whatever is inside the square brackets is actually the Fourier transform of h of t minus tau. And by the shifting property, we know that this is equal to the Fourier transform of h of t multiplied by a complex exponential e minus j omega tau. That's how we get to the third line. So in the end, in the third line, we'll get the integral of x of tau, h of j omega, e minus j omega tau d tau. And once again, h of j omega does not depend on tau. We can take it out of the integral, and what remains in the integral is simply the Fourier transform of x. Therefore, we've proven our relationship, which says that y of j omega is ultimately equal to h of j omega times x of j omega. We saw in an earlier class that the impulse response h of t completely characterizes an LTI system. And the same is true for its Fourier transform, the frequency response h of j omega. We also saw that the impulse response of the cascade of two systems is the convolution of the impulse responses of the individual systems. And the convolution property implies that the overall frequency response of the cascade of two systems is simply the product of the individual frequency responses. And therefore, the overall frequency response does not depend on the order of the cascade, as it is illustrated in this slide. Let's see a few examples where we will apply the convolution property now. The first example we see is a simple time shift system. For this system, the impulse response h of t is a Dirac delta, delta of t minus t0, right? This has the feature of causing a time shift of the input by a quantity t0, which can be positive or negative. The Fourier transform of this, h of j omega, is e to minus j omega t0. We've seen this because the Fourier transform of the delta, remember, is 1, but this is a shifted delta and therefore its transform is 1 times that complex exponential. So for a generic input x of t which has Fourier transform x of j omega, what's the output? The output can be calculated as the convolution between x and h of t. In this case, h of t is delta of t minus t0, and we know that doing the convolution with a delta centered in t0 causes a shift of the original signal by t0. So the convolution between x of t and delta of t minus t0 is x of t minus t0. What happens in the frequency domain? Well, now we know and we can say that y of j omega is going to be the product of the two Fourier transforms, h of j omega times x of j omega. And in particular, h of j omega is e to minus j omega t0. Therefore, the output of this system for a given input x is going to be x of j omega times e minus j omega t0 in the frequency domain. Another example that is of interest is the one of a differentiator system. So imagine a system that gives you as an output the derivative of the input signal. So y of t is dxt in dt. Therefore, the Fourier transform of the output y of j omega is going to be j omega x of j omega because of the differentiation property that we've seen before. As a consequence, h of j omega, the frequency response of the system, which can be seen as the division between y j omega and x j omega, is simply j omega in this case. Similarly, we can study the integrator system. So an integrator system is a system that gives you as an output the integral function of your input signal. So we could write that y of t is the integral between minus infinity and t of x of tau d tau. And recall that this is equivalent to having a system with impulse response u of t, the Heaviside function. So again, y of t is the convolution between x of t and u of t, where u of t represents the integrator. Therefore, in the Fourier transform domain, h of j omega, which is the Fourier transform of the impulse response, which in this case is u of t, is going to be 1 over j omega plus pi delta of omega. This is the Fourier transform of the Heaviside function, which we saw in a previous class. And what about the Fourier transform of the output y of j omega? Well, this again can be obtained as the product between h of j omega and x of j omega, and therefore it's simply 1 over j omega x of j omega plus pi x of 0 delta of omega. The last term comes from the fact that when you multiply x of j omega times delta of omega, The result is x of 0 delta of omega. We've seen this property quite a few times by now. One more example that is of interest is the one of a filter. Let's start with a frequency selective filter. So this is an ideal filter. It's a filter that in the frequency domain h of j omega has a gain equal to 1 and within a pass band, and it has a gain equal to 0 in what we call a stop band. So for frequencies omega smaller than omega c, the filter allows the input signal to pass unaltered, whereas it suppresses everything else at any other frequency outside that band. What is the impulse response that corresponds to the system? We would obtain it by anti-transforming h of j omega. And as we've seen in a previous class, the anti-transform of a rectangular signal is a sinc signal. In particular, in this case, it's the sine of omega c t over pi t. So what's interesting to see is that if we plot these two signals, h of j omega, the frequency response, and h of t, the impulse response, you have them at the bottom of this slide. We can study the properties respectively in the frequency and time domains. So there is perfect frequency selectivity, as we have said at the beginning. So the value of h of g omega is 1 in the pass band and 0 in the stop band. However, in the time domain, the filter is non-causal and it has oscillations because it has a sync behavior. So here we see some issues that arise in filter design by looking at both the time and frequency domains. While the ideal low-pass filter has perfect frequency selectivity, its impulse response has undesirable features. It is not causal, it is not easy to approximate closely, and it presents oscillatory behavior, which may be unacceptable in certain applications. Think of a car suspension system, for example. So one option is to trade off perfect frequency selectivity with some desirable time domain features. So now we see as another example a frequency selective filter which is not ideal but rather smooth. So how do we design this filter? We take as an impulse response h of t at right-sided exponential e to minus t u of t. You see it depicted at the bottom left of the slide. The Fourier transform of the signal, if we just apply the definition as we already have done previously, is h of j omega equal 1 over j omega plus 1, right? So we see that depicted at the bottom right of the slide. So we see that in this case, the response of the filter in time domain is causal without oscillations, unlike the previous one. However, the frequency selectivity is weaker. This filter is not ideal. This filter decays smoothly in the frequency domain, and therefore it doesn't attenuate perfectly in the stop band, and it does cause some undesirable distortion, perhaps in the pass band, but this could be tolerable. So the advantage is that the system can be implemented with a simple RC circuit. So while it doesn't have the strong frequency selectivity of the ideal low-pass filter, it's causal and its impulse response decays monotonically without any oscillations. Another reason why the convolution property can be very useful is when we need to evaluate a convolution integral, because sometimes this could be difficult to do in the time domain, but much easier to do in the frequency domain. So this is what this example is meant to illustrate. Imagine that you have a system with impulse response h of t given by e to minus a t u of t, right? With a positive. So it's a right-sided exponential again. And imagine that your input is also a right-sided exponential, just with a different parameter, b. So the output of the system, y of t, would be given by the convolution between h and x. And how do we calculate it? We could actually calculate the convolution with the convolution integral. This could be a little bit cumbersome though, and there's an easier way of doing that. What is it? So we could work in the frequency domain. We could transform first of all both h and x and obtain their respective Fourier transforms, h of j omega and x of j omega. These are very easily obtained, and we actually have seen them already. They're respectively 1 over a plus j omega and 1 over b plus j omega. Then, thanks to the convolution property, we know that y of j omega, the Fourier transform of the output, will be given by the product between h of j omega and x of j omega. And this can be easily written as 1 over a plus j omega times b plus j omega. What do we need to do now? We simply need to anti-transform, because anti-transforming y of j omega will give us y of t. This is the tricky bit, but nothing to be scared about. So let's assume that b and a are different. In that case, what we find very useful here is expanding y of j omega in partial fractions. What does that mean? It means rewriting that fraction 1 over a plus j omega times b plus j omega in the form a over a plus j omega plus b over b plus j omega, where a and b are coefficients to be determined. How to determine the coefficients? One simple way is to multiply both left and right hand sides by a plus j omega times b plus j omega, and then equating the two sides. That will give us a system of two equations from which we can determine a and b. And this is what we're doing in this slide. And at the end of the calculations, which are rather simple, we obtain that a is 1 over b minus a and b is 1 over a minus b, so the opposite of a. If we just substitute this on top, we obtain the last line of this slide, where y of j omega is 1 over b minus a times the square brackets. Notice that in the square brackets we have two terms which we can easily anti-transform by simple inspection, because we have encountered them previously and we know that each has as an anti-transform a right-sided exponential. Therefore, from that and from the linearity property, we can write that y of t is 1 over b minus a times e to minus a t minus e to minus b t u of t. What we have just seen is valid when b and a are different. For a equal b, we can operate in a different manner. So when b is equal to a, we have the special case where y of j omega is 1 over the square of a plus j omega. So in this case, we use a different trick to calculate the anti-transform. We recall first that the right-sided exponential has as a Fourier transform 1 over a plus j omega. And we recall that from the dual differentiation property, meaning differentiating in the frequency domain corresponds to multiplying by minus jt in the time domain, we can write the line below. We can write that t e minus a t u of t has as a Fourier transform j times the derivative in the omega of 1 over a plus j omega. But if you do calculate that derivative, you see that that is exactly equal to 1 over a plus j omega squared, which is the expression that we're trying to anti-transform. Therefore, we already have the result. We have that the anti-transform we're looking for is t e minus a t u of t. So in this case, the output has a different form. It's not e to minus a t u of t. It's not of the type of a decaying exponential. It's t multiplying by such quantity, because b and a are equal. The main takeaway from today's class is the important relationship between convolution in time domain and multiplication in frequency domain. This allows us to study the behavior of LTI systems through their frequency response h of j omega. In the next class, we'll learn and make use of the dual property, which is that multiplication in time domain corresponds to convolution in frequency domain. See you in the next video.